would like to tell you something about reaction sintering method. Reaction sintering is a way to produce ceramic materials in such a way that at least some of composite phases don't exist in the beginning, don't exist as your starting components, but instead appear during the crystallization process. It is well known that intense interaction resulting in refractory material appearance often occurs at temperatures which are lower than the melting point. For example, the titanium tiburide can be fully densified at temperature of, for example, 1400 degrees C, while its melting point is 3300 degrees C. So when titanium tiburide appear, it is rather cold for it, and the poor creature should crystallize at once. Critical nuclear size is 3 nanometers at such conditions. So when titanium tiburide crystallizes at 1400 degrees C, it can be of 3 nanometer crystals. So it is quite possible that they can be reaction sintering routes to produce ceramic materials with considerable content of nanoscale grains. And I would like to present you our investigation of such routes. We produce all of the samples with graphite pairs, our homemade plant and breadwinner. Parameters you can see in this slide. And the first way to obtain ceramic material we call liquid phase reaction sintering. You need to have fusible components which can result during the exothermic reaction, which can result refractory phases. In our case, we had titanium, aluminum, and boron oxide at the temperature of 700 degrees C. Aluminum and boron oxide are liquid, and at 900 degrees C, first aluminum crystals appear. Boron atoms released during the reaction diffuse into titanium grains, as well as titanium atoms dissolve into the melt. After heating the material up to 1200 Celsius degrees, we have titanium tiburide grains. You see, this substance is fully dense. We have no pores here, so we expected to have our material pulp, non-porous ceramic material at once when we have full reaction, means at 1400 Celsius degrees. But actually, we couldn't have such results, and we had our bulk materials only at 1600 degrees C, and only after 8 minutes at a pressure of 30 megapascals, 300 atmospheres. You know, it's strange where this substance took its pores. Deliberately, we swept our heads long enough to understand the peculiarity of the process and called the effect as secondary porosity formation effect. The matter of fact is that our product's density was much higher than that of initial phases, and when product grains formed hard skeleton, further reaction produces porosity, which can be eliminated only after a plastic flow of new grains. This secondary porosity is not very It was sufficient, sufficient as well to grow other aluminum grains. You can see that aluminum grains are like 2 or 3 micrometers, but titanium dichloride is absolutely another matter. And titanium dichloride particles did not exceed 200 nanometers, and here again, among them, we have no less than 30% of nanoscale grains. Well, so we obtained the overall content of nanoparticles, like 10% in our composite. Well, the second way I want to present you here is, extension of liquid phase direction sintering to other materials. Here we had boron oxide, aluminum and carbon reaction mixture, and titanium dichloride as inert phase. Titanium dichloride didn't react during the sintering process, and we used our reaction mixture to densify titanium dichloride grains, and we achieved full densification at 1900 degrees C during 4 minutes. We can see the overall structure of the composite here, large titanium dichloride grains inside the matrix of inside the aluminum-based matrix. And this aluminum-based matrix during the sintering process had to be reinforced with boron carbide plate-like submicron grains. And nanograins, they are not very well, can be seen well enough, but they are there. Well, and the reinforcement of our matrix with boron carbide, submicron, and nanoparticles allowed us to have a fracture toughness of 9 megapascals times the root meter. Well, and I can tell you that both presented components, first one fully fusible reaction sintering and this one, well, they have one problem which is secondary to loss of deformation. It is because of the lithometric effect, because our product phases had higher density than starting components. And it is quite simple. How to solve the problem? We just should find such a starting powder mixture that its density would be higher than that of product ones, and then we will eliminate secondary cost of deformation. We have now secondary cost of deformation. Well, we started to find out such possibility. We were looking for it in different places within the year. We tried very hard. But at last I understood that it seems a basic part of all the liquid phase correction sintering, when we have refractory grains as our products. And now I pass to the third part of my report, so-called heteromodule ceramics. Heteromodule ceramics present a combination of high Young-Modulus matrix with soft inclusions. Soft inclusions means graphite or graphite-like or nitride inclusions. Melting points of soft phases are more than 3000 degrees C, so it is quite expected that to produce heteromodule ceramics you need extra high temperatures, and my colleague Professor Shabarian, for example, used 2700 degrees C during 30 minutes to produce his titanium carbide graphite composite, but such a temperature is very high to power for our homemade plant. Besides, we get used to obtain our composites in such a way 100 degrees C. During 16 minutes, expected temperature of starting the powder showed us only titanium boron carbides, but not a soaking time. 16 minutes at 1800 degrees C. We had titanium dichloride and graphite, this thing, graphite B. So we have better molecular ceramics reaction compressed. Such reaction occurred during our sintering process. The structure of the composites, whether it was predictable enough, when we have a great amount of boron carbide, we have boron carbide matrix, dark phase, and titanium dichloride and graphite inclusions. You can't see graphite inclusions here because boron carbide is dark enough to hide them. Well, when we have stoichiometric components ratio, we have titanium dichloride, it is white phase, titanium dichloride matrix and graphite black phase inclusions. We had up to 33% of graphite inclusions in titanium dichloride. And when we have titanium dichloride based matter, titanium carbide, a titanium carbide with one boron carbide, we had titanium dichloride and carbide based matrix, and as well graphic inclusions which can be seen here. So three different structures, and macrophages of the composites has this minimum and respectable minimum at stoichiometric ratio, because you know a third part of your composite with as graphite, you cannot have very tight ceramic or very hard ceramics. Actually, this sample, I could drill ceramics with melting point of 3000 Celsius degrees and more. I drilled with a drill, fracture toughness at two maximums, not so expectable, but these maximums were at the same graphite content. Graphite could not only weaken the material, but also arrest cracks in it. And structural regularities, you see titanium dichloride grains, large ones and little ones, less than 200 nanometers, again during the compressing process, and such voids, you can see them with plain walls presenting crystalline structure, again during our compressing process. Well, I should finish my report. The form of graphite inclusion, submicron graphite inclusion in composites. Well, we produced three different types of different structures of our composites. Low process parameters and high mechanical properties make them attractive for practical purposes. We will be led to find partners for scientific cooperation, and thank you for your attention.
As I understood, at first you have an initial material, then it shrinks, and then after some treatment it becomes more fluffy. Can you tell about the sizes of the pores in the initial, in the intermediate, and in the last material?
Thank you for the question. Initial material, initial material was just powder. Just a powder, it was like 40 to 60% of pores, if you want to call them pores. So, and during shrinkage, we have another phase formation, and achieved full density.
No pores at all?
No pores at all, but no pores at all in some composites. In other composites, we had not pores but voids. Voids which formed during the sintering process.
Much bigger, yeah.
Not bigger, they are from 3 micrometers to 100 nanometers, actually. The voice is more appropriate.
And I would like to thank you for such an entertaining report. It was a pleasure to see this.
Thank you.
Any questions? Let's answer.